in the lab, doing stuff, making something. Fran, in the lab, with my Geiger counter, clicking away. This is actually it's a Geiger-Müller tube Geiger counter. This one's actually got two. It's got the Geiger-Müller sort of alpha, beta, gamma tube with the little window I can open up to get alpha, beta, and gamma. Or it's also, and it's also got this separate side mount, just gamma tube. So. Kind of covers all the bases, but I use this surprisingly a lot. And recently I had it out, was just going around the lab looking for really minute, like low level radioactive sources that are sort of in our everyday environment, and just kind of learning a little bit about these things that are part of our lives all the time that normally we can't see or sense, except if you've got an instrument like this Geiger counter that's allowing you to see it. So one of the things I did is one of the things I checked was one of my pocket watches. This one is my 1927 Illinois. It's a porcelain face. This was fully restored for me a few years ago by a really great watch guy, and I opened up the tube here, and I noticed that it's got a signature slightly above background. So let's listen for a minute, listen to the clicks that are going on just for the normal background. Right? It's just slightly above background. immediately people are gonna say, oh, Frank, you got a radium watch. No, it's not radium. If you wanna see, or better yet, hear what a radium clock sounds like, I'll put the link in the description and you can go and look at the radium clock that someone sent in for viewer mail. They didn't realize it was a radium dial clock, but I put the Geiger counter on that and that's what radium sounds like. No, this is very, very, very low level. It's just above background. But I thought, you know, maybe the ceramic, because it is a porcelain, there could be like heavy elements in the porcelain mix. You never really know. But I thought, you know, maybe it's the crystal, you know, because this crystal on this watch is a lead crystal. And lead crystals, like, I think it's like 25% or more, 30%, something like lead oxide or something in the crystal. And there is a certain amount in all lead, refined lead, there's always a minute amount, just like a fraction of a percent of contamination of heavier elements like thorium and uranium that are in the ore that get into the refined metals. So I figured there was like a tiny minuscule amount of maybe uranium or thorium mixed in with the crystal. It was giving it a slight signature. So I thought, well, maybe I should get some other crystal to test. And I got a wine glass here. Now, they stopped putting lead in drinking glasses, like stemware, quite some time ago. But they substitute other metals, like potassium oxide and barium oxide. But barium and potassium both have radioactive isotopes. I'll get into potassium in a moment, but this, I believe, is a barium oxide glass because it is quite heavy. It's heavier than regular glass, so it is got some weight to it. Barium in nature contains a small amount of a radioactive isotope, barium-130, which I think is it's like a tenth of a percent of the total, you know, in all barium that's found. And so I figured this might also have a signature. So I'm gonna close up the alpha beta window and put the barium glass up against the gamma tube. Bit above background, just a smidge, you know. You know what else has a surprising radioactive signature above the background is yours truly. let's see what it says when I point it at me. Just a little bit above background. And that comes from the fact that we ingest all kinds of materials. Our body's made up of a lot of atoms, including a lot of carbon and a lot of potassium. And about more than half of the radiation that the human body gives off is from the potassium-40 that we depend on. you can't live without potassium. And potassium-40, it's part of it. It's like a hundredth of a percent of all the potassium. It's potassium-40. Well, what's the safe amount of radiation I can be exposed to? Is it watch glass level? Is it wine glass level? Is it granite countertop level? Well, there is a standard, and it's called the banana equivalent dose, the BAD. It's roughly the amount of radiation you get from consuming a banana. And as a rule of thumb, they generally say that for safe doses for anything that you're handling, you should never have more than like 3 bananas in a day. So like a 3 banana equivalent dose. And you're saying, well, what possibly does a banana sound like with a Geiger counter? Well, I'll tell you. All right, come on, bananas. I got a bunch of bananas here. I got 3 bananas. You can hear the Geiger counter already starting to act up. So they say that 3 bananas is the maximum dosage you should get. So let's hear what that sounds like. That's pretty much banana radiation right there. So, you know, it's above background, but, it's about the same signature I was getting from myself, actually. You know, that's the potassium-40. So, if we use this, banana-level radiation as sort of a guide of, what's safe, then, anything with that kind of signature, it's going to be totally fine, A few clicks here and there, above background, but just a smidge. Yeah. Again, compare the banana with the watch crystal. See, my watch is about half a banana. it's a little bit like half a banana, I'd say, for the watch crystal. And the wine glass a little more. But anyway, it's very interesting, the way that the lead having like a little bit of like uranium and thorium in it is because of the radioactive decay of uranium. It decays from uranium to radium to radon to polonium, and then it decays into either thorium or lead. And so the geological association between like thorium, lead, and uranium, it's kind of intrinsic. You can't really have lead without a little bit of thorium and uranium in it. It's kind of something you wouldn't think of as, lead being what you use to insulate from radiation, but lead itself, all lead is slightly radioactive just because it contains a little bit of uranium and thorium in it. So, but you wouldn't know that if you didn't have your own Geiger counter and went exploring for micro radiation. So I want to take a close-up of the clicker box, because a lot of people talk about this. They want to know about the clicker box and you know, how I made it. So let's take a close-up look at the schematic. Alrighty, this is it, simple schematic. This is all this is. It's just a LM386. I use one of the little 8-ohm gift, you know, those gift card speakers, like I used in the Happy Fuzzmas holiday card. I got an LED mounted in there, and I got a three-position switch. It's basically on, and the center position is off. So that's why it's represented like this. So center's off, so on and on the other side. I wasn't really sure how loud this box would be, and I didn't exactly know exactly how strong the signal coming from the Geiger counter was going to be, so I used this on switch so that I could have two different selections for the input. And so in one position it's just going right into the amplifier, and the other it's attenuated. So I got two 10k resistors just in a voltage divider, attenuates it down 50% before it goes into the capacitor. It's just a 0.1 microfarad going right into a LM386, and then the output goes to a 10 mic non-polar cap, and then right down to the 8 ohm dynamic speaker. And I've also got an LED and a little 1.5K running off a 9-volt battery. And it pulls about 10 milliamps static. That's without actually making any clicks. It's going to pull more current when the speaker is actually clicking, but the standby current is 10 milliamps. So you'll get like forever on a 9-volt battery with that. And that's with the LED too. So very simple. And this is, you know, just my standard, simple, very basic little mini amplifier. Works great. If you get one of these Geiger counters, this one is military surplus. I got it from a dealer that was, you know, had like a whole like skid of them. They came from the Department of Homeland Security, which is why they've got the Department of Homeland Security label on it. And this one really stands to be recalibrated and recapped because the actual like analog meter gauge is kind of slow. It has like all banks of these large value capacitors for storing charges, because it's all based on like DC to register on the needle. You know, it collects clicks, and then those clicks are converted into a voltage, which is then on this and yada yada. I don't ever use the meter though. I just use it to count clicks. So I'm just using the amplifier and the audio output. But it could stand to be recalibrated and such. Although I have to say I got a really good deflection when I put it on that radium clock a few years ago. But you know, everybody should have a Geiger-Müller counter. You know, one of these really good ones with the multi-band tube, alpha, beta, gamma tube setup, you know, with the window. It's really the way to go. Every lab should have one of these. It's indispensable. I use it a lot, actually, particularly if you're, you know, buying parts, you know, old Soviet bloc parts that come from Ukraine or whatever and have been in a bunker for 30 years. Yeah, you know, when you get that in, before you really have at it, you might want to give it a sniff with a Geiger-Müller tube just to see if it's got, like, anything funky on it. I know I do. So, but yeah, it's just also fascinating to explore your world and find the various things that have very slight and sometimes, you know, hard to detect, but still there, minute radioactive signatures. They're everywhere. That's it for this one. Thanks for watching. Hope you found it interesting and informative. I know I had fun. I don't need any excuse for me to pull out my Geiger counter. I'm such a geek. Oh, what did you do last night? Oh, I pulled out my Geiger counter and went around the lab, and I was just testing everything, looking for micro radioactive sources. Would you know that if granite countertop is... Yeah, okay, yeah, fine. I didn't even take it into the kitchen with the granite countertop. That's also kind of fun. You get little veins, you know, that are like more radioactive. It's just, anyway. But everyone should have a Geiger-Müller tube. These are, I mean, they're not like that expensive. You get them like government surplus. There's lots of them out there. I know the Department of Homeland Security had like tons of these things that they decommissioned a few years ago, and you know, you can get them for a song, and you know, yeah, highly recommend picking one up for your lab. Anyway, I'm Fran. I'll be back here real soon. I want to thank all of the patrons over there on the Patreon. Thank you. It's true, you know, the patrons, they make everything possible here, you know, all the videos I do. If you like what I do, if you want to help FranLab continue into the future, consider becoming a patron. Get free perks and everything, you know, bonus videos, you get to see everything in advance, they get, you know, advanced release on all the videos and all that stuff. You'll be in the in crowd. Anyway, that's it. I'm Fran. I'll see you back here real soon. Bye! That's where I work. Berserk in my lab, it's where I work. Radiation-y. And delicious.